space for many biomedical applications, such as biomedical natural language processing, information retrieval, and clinical decision support. So given the important role biomedical coding plays, so we must ensure the quality of the knowledge source first to further guarantee the quality of the all downstream applications that are using oncologists as the knowledge source. So this paper we focused on specifically address the challenge of quality assurance for SNOMED CT, which is a very comprehensive clinical terminology used worldwide. And it is used by many countries. And in the United States, it is mandated by the US government for encoding for clinical information. So SNOMED CT conceptually is organized in a directed cyclic graph. We also call it that. So it contains over 300,000 nodes. So and the nodes actually are further organized into 19 different hierarchies at the first level, if you can see, including body structure, clinical findings, and procedures and the substances. And there are also over a million edges between the concepts. So here what we are showing is just hierarchical is a relation hierarchy. So there are also some other hierarchy, other relational information. And this SNOMED CT is maintained and delivered by the International Health Terminology Standard Development Organization. They have a release like twice each year, two versions. So this example shows a very small non-lattice subgraph in the SNOMED CT terminology. So first, if you take a close look at the three nodes down at the bottom, can you see any, do you have any findings? Just by looking at the concept descriptions at the bottom.
It seems like the two to the right should be
right. So basically, just by briefly looking at this, there should be two relations. These two should be attached to under this one, right? That's a subtype. So basically, this non-lattice subgraph reveals two missing hierarchical relations. So this is just one example I'm showing. You know, because SNOMED CT is such a large terminology and we have so many relationships, how can we find such examples systematically to help with the quality assurance of the terminology or oncology? So that's again illustrating from the background such a large graph, how can we find specific ones and, you know, stress potential fractions. So it's like finding needles in the stack. So it's really nice. So our strategy to or sometimes it's like missing concepts. So our motivation and focus for this paper was to develop an automatic method to systematically detect this kind of missing relations or missing concepts, and further provide automatic suggestions based on those patterns. So this is the novel paper because many existing quality assurance approaches do not have the ability to do the multiple suggestions of practice. And this one was specifically leverage both the graph, underlying graph structure and the lexical information of the nodes for concepts. So we'll see. So this is a brief definition of a lattice. Basically, if you consider the lattice as a specific type of depth, which each two nodes will have a unique minimal former descendant, maximal descendant, and have a unique minimal common ancestor, and sometimes they are called like minimal upper bound and maximal lower bound. So as long as they have a unique one, then this group structure or the what called as a lattice. So the examples we are showing here, for example, we can take like look at the first column. So we have A, B, C, and D actually maybe originally it should be one concept, but you know the terminology curator or ontology maintainer may accidentally you know make two concepts about them. So basically they just make two concepts, and this is the cause of non-lattice structure. So the second example is second, three, the third, and four are some other examples that originally they should be a lattice, but because of the modeling issue or you know the maintaining issue, they got into the non-lattice structure. So that's the kind of intuition why we investigate some non-lattice graphs for fragments. So more formally in mathematical theory, why do we investigate in the non-lattice graph? Because the normal ontology engineering way is you have the collection of objects and a collection of attributes, and you have the final relationship between the objects and attributes, like here shown in the course in the table above. And using the formal concept analysis of mathematical theory backend from the theory, we can automatically derive a hierarchical structure showing that here. And by formal concept analysis, such derived hierarchy would form a lattice. So basically, this is the mathematical support for this. A well-defined or well-formalized ontology to conform to the lattice. So this is explained. It should, if we are building the ontology from the intention extension object attribute link, it should be a lattice. But in reality, when the terminology maintainer or curator are creating the ontology, they are not looking at object attributes. They are directly modeling concepts and putting the hierarchy relationship between concepts. So our idea was to reverse. reversely computing the minimal common ancestor again based on those three nodes we got. So basically, the rationale to do a reverse computing computation is, for example, if this C1 and C2 share the maximum common descendants of these three nodes, and if there is one node, infection node there, they can also form a seed pair with either C1 and C2, but they will also share the maximum common descendants as these three nodes. So if we don't compute reversely, then we'll need to investigate redundant information. So that's why we reversely computing it to make it like as close as possible and save the redundant effort for investigating this. So and for notation, we call this from the lower we'll call this as low boundary and the top ones as the upper boundary. So we'll use this lower boundary and the upper boundary notation in the later. Later when we identify those patterns. So what we have introduced is how we compute the non-lattice subgraph from purely the graph structure. Then it's time for us to integrate the lexical notation. But basically, we specifically investigated four lexical patterns based on the non-lattice subgraph. So here, when I use L, it means some concept in the lower boundary. When I use U, it means some concept in the upper boundary. So for lower boundary and the upper boundary, there will be at least two concepts. So that's the requirement. So basically, the containment pattern would be if some concept in the upper boundary, we consider each concept as a set of words. If the set of words in for one concept in the upper boundary is a subset of the word for the concept another concept in the upper boundary, then we call it a containment pattern. Similarly for lower boundary. So in this case, we may automatically suggest a correction for this one. We'll see in later examples. And similarly, we have the intersection. Basically means the there are two concepts whose set of words to an intersection is equal to the set of words in the one concept in the upper boundary. Similarly, we have the union pattern and the union intersection. We'll see the detail and examples here. So this one is a containment. Basically, if you take a look at the left-hand graph first, then if you see the set of words in the lower boundary, you will see this one is, the left one would be a subset of the right one. So in this situation, we generally suggest a mismatch relationship from the one, the superset, the subset. And in this specific example, it's similar to the one we have seen for the first example, for that white eye. So for intersection pattern, if you see here, this is the intersection of the set of words for the two concepts in the lower boundary actually is equal to the set of words for the concept interval for symbiome in the upper bound. So basically, this one generally suggests a missing relationship between the concept in the upper boundary here. Basically, interval for symbiome should be a disorder of column. So this is for the intersection pattern. So the union pattern is like the union of the set of words in the upper boundary is equal to the set of words of one concept in the lower boundary. So for example here, the union is, you see, equal to the the schema of skin and the polygons use the Euclidean plasma of skin. So basically, it should be, you know, a subtype of the malignant axial neoplasma that combine the top one words together. So that's one of the most intuition or motivation why this kind of patterns just the missing hierarchical relationship between the concepts here in the lower boundary. And we have the last pattern is called union interception, which generally suggests a missing concept instead of a missing relationship. So here, if you see the interception of the sample words in the lower boundary is exactly the same as the union of the concepts in the upper boundary. So basically, this pattern always suggests a missing concept sitting in the middle of them. If you relink them, add the missing concept and relink them, they will form a lattice. So basically, we specifically explore this kind of lexical patterns based on the underlying graph structure to detect those and also provide suggestions for correction. So we used the 2015 member version, US edition, to do the experiment, and there are over 600,000 pairs detected. As you can see in the other paper, we got over 5,500. So it's still increasing, basically meaning the terminology itself is growing, but the problem is still there and also increasing. And so for the non-lattice subgraph, because we did the reverse computation, so we got less number of non-lattice subgraphs. And we specifically calculate like the size of the subgraph. Actually, surprisingly, the largest one is like containing over 500,000 nodes. But this paper, for evaluation, we specifically use the smaller ones to do the evaluation because smaller ones are easy to inspect visually and also easier to make sense of them. And another interesting finding you can hear is if you see the dashed circle one, that's a non-lattice subgraph actually embedded in a larger non-lattice subgraph. So basically, this is some statistic of how many size 4 subgraphs are contained in the larger ones. So that's why in this paper we specifically focused on the smaller ones because, you know, if we fix the problem in the smaller ones, for those larger ones, containing smaller ones, at least for exactly the same substructure, they will be automatically fixed as well. So it's kind of, we see it as an iterative process. And these are some, you know, numbers about the smaller size one and for each pattern. So overall, we've got around 2,000 smaller subgraphs following the four lexical patterns we have introduced. And for the evaluation, we randomly choose 100 subgraphs and render it using the tag and SVG to like you see here for top is the original fragment and the down is the outstretched one we got. And these were provided to the domain expert. And the we provided to the Max, is just purely view a PDF document. But how can we make it like usable and shareable by multiple domain experts and help them to visualize smaller ones to fix the technical problem? We developed a prototype system here. So basically, you can search all these different datasets to get the interesting fragments. Let's see. So this one will allow you to choose specific little hierarchy, sub-hierarchy. So for example, here is tree clinical finding. And if you click search in fragment, you can put any keywords you are interested for looking into. For example, this one I'm specifically looking for the iterable ball syndrome to see if we can get the one we just see in the slides, previous slide. And you can also specify the size of the fragment to that in this case it's 4 to 8. Then when you do the query, it will have the candidate who are populate, and if you see, that's exactly the one we have seen in the previous one of the previous slides. And left hand side is the original subgraph, and the right hand side is the automated expression. And here we also allow them to download these pictures into different formats, and also save such kind of fragments when it's interesting for reuse and saving. So, and after you save this fragment, you can go to my fragments and load the interesting ones you have saved for reuse. Excuse me.
We have 1 minute.
Okay. Then I think I will stop here because the rest one will be focusing on the some discussion. So the next few slides will be just focusing on discussion limitations. I will just stop here, you know, starting the time. Do you have any questions? Yes,
please. How do I get to your graph website?
So you see the URL there. Currently it's win.img.uky.edu/snomed.exe. Let me see the documents.
Is there a link to your page?
I don't have it, but let me just say it and I can type it. It's win.uky.edu/win_expo. That's
okay.
I can send you a link for make it available if anyone.
very interesting. I'm sure many people will want to go to that website and play with it. Thank you very much.